In the heart of Africa, straddling the borders of Rwanda, Uganda, and Congo, lies a remarkable mountain kingdom. It's home to the last 700 mountain gorillas in the world. With so few left, they're under constant surveillance from a dedicated band of humans, a species in intensive care. Our cameras have been given privileged access to these precious animals by the people that record every detail of their lives. In this program, we'll be following some of the youngest and most vulnerable gorillas. We witness the plight of two orphans caught in a brutal civil war. A young female on the cusp of adulthood, battling with feelings she's unable to control. And a new gorilla king, struggling to earn the respect of the group he fought so hard to win. In these uncertain times, is the mountain gorilla's future safe in our hands? On the volcanic slopes of the mountains of Rwanda, there has been momentous change. Titus, the 35-year-old gorilla king, is dead. At his peak, he ruled over 25 gorillas and became the most successful silverback in recorded history. Now, his reign is over. The young orphan he protected has also lost his struggle for life. Titus was hounded to the point of exhaustion by a younger silverback, his son, Ranu. The old ruler simply couldn't fight anymore, slowly fading away, until finally one morning he simply didn't wake up, worn out by life and his own son. For Rwandan gorilla researcher Felix Undajijimana, it's the end of an era.
Titus was one of my favorite gorillas, and I guess he was everybody's favorite, not only me. Now that Titus is gone and Ranu's taken over the group, I'd say that he's keeping the group together, and that's the most important, but it's really hard for the individuals in the group to accept him as a leader, especially Tak, the only female of the group who had a very close relationship with Titus. You can see that the group is not as close as it used to be when Titus was still alive.
At just 17 years old, Ranu is the same age as his father was when he became leader of this group. Ranu is discovering that to be a great silverback, it's not enough just to be the son of a once great king. Already, things aren't looking good. The other gorillas seem reluctant to accept him as their new leader. Tuck, the only female in the group, is on the verge of leaving. She only stays because of her young son. Before Titus's death, he was a confident four-year-old. Now he's regressed, becoming more reliant on his mother. Tuck is torn between her duty as a parent and her contempt for Ran. This is a group in turmoil, and its leader needs to prove himself. Can Ranu win their confidence and keep the group together? Mountain gorillas are a species in intensive care. Around 700 remain in the wild, and everything humanly possible is done to keep them safe. The mountain gorilla vets are a vital part of this effort. They're dedicated to monitoring the gorilla's health and can be called upon at a moment's notice. Magda Braun is one of those vets. She has worked with apes for over 10 years. Today she's traveling from her base in Rwanda and crossing the border into Congo to the town of Goma. Congo is home to around 200 mountain gorillas, about a third of the total population. A huge country, it was the location of the Great War of Africa, a conflict that began in 1998 and involved 8 nations and around 25 armed groups. Today, the war's over, but Eastern Congo, where the mountain gorillas live, is still home to many armed rebels.
Today I'm going to Congo to check on Desi and Afazi, our two mountain gorilla orphans. And they have been with us in the temporary facility in Goma. And Goma is not the right climate. It's a very crowded place. We have lots and lots of health problems because of that. And we were trying for a long time to find them the better area. And finally there is the sanctuary in Omangabo. It's actually exactly the place where they come from. Had a call from our vets in Goma that they had a little bit of a cough, which is nothing unusual in this time of year. So most likely it's nothing serious, but as I said, we have to be sure that they are fit for the move.
The hope is that the two orphan gorillas will pass Magda's health check and be moved from the hot, dusty town to their new home in the forest. In a small house in the middle of the forest, lives gorilla scientist Martha Robbins. She has studied mountain gorillas for 20 years, the past 12 here in Uganda, where around 300 mountain gorillas are found.
I
ventures out into the forest to observe the gorillas firsthand.
The habitat here is very good for gorillas. What makes it so difficult for us to walk around is actually great for the gorillas because there's herbaceous vegetation everywhere for the gorillas to eat. We have much more fruit trees here, which the gorillas definitely like fruit. And so that's sort of an added resource for the gorillas.
Thanks to the work of people like Martha, we now know that Ugandan gorillas eat more fruit than the gorillas in Rwanda, that they spend more time in the trees, and that they have larger home ranges. Martha's dedication to studying these animals has allowed her to gain the trust of one gorilla in particular, the successful silverback leader, Rochina. She leads a group of 14 that includes 6 females. With so many females in his group, Silverback Rochina's life couldn't be more different to that of Ranu back in Rwanda. The dominant silverback claims exclusive rights to the females, and given the chance, will mate every few hours. The junior blackbacks can only look on. But for one little gorilla, the temptation to get involved is just too great. 10-month-old Ponoka is the youngest in the group, and although Rochina is probably his father, he could be pushing his luck. One in three gorillas die before 3 years of age. The first year is the riskiest. Martha can't wait for little Ponoka to reach that milestone. Although Ponoka is the youngest in this group, he's not the newest arrival. That honor goes to a young female called Twijike. Females often move between groups to avoid mating with their fathers, and now in Rochina's group, the innocent-looking Twijike is about to cause chaos. Gorilla researcher Felix is on his way to see the new silverback leader, Ranu. For Felix, this is a chance to reacquaint himself with a gorilla he knew many years ago, and find out how the new leader and the old female Tuck are getting on. There's little doubt that Silverback Ranu would love to claim his hard-earned right to the female in his group. But at 37 years old, Tuck is most definitely not interested in sex. Nearly all females stop by their mid to late 30s. Unfortunately, Ranu doesn't know this. And keeps trying to impress. impress her with his displays of strength. But all this seems to do is make Tuck more determined to ignore him. As Ranu continues to hunt Tuck, her sons come to her defense. Now the smallest gorilla in the group decides to show the mighty silverback Ranu who's in charge. This is hardly the great leader in control. Pushed around by the youngest male in the group and spurned by Tuck, the only female, things couldn't get much worse. Just 40 kilometers away in the forests of Uganda, things are stirring for the 8-year-old female, Twijike. She arrived in the group just 2 months ago, and Martha's log shows that, up until now, she's been keeping a low profile. But today, she only has eyes for Ruchina, her silverback leader.
The way she's staring at him like that, that's classic solicitation. Very subtle, as gorillas are. She wants to mate, I'm not sure he does.
Advancing on him, she tightens her lips and stares straight into his eyes, sure signs that she wants to mate. But Ruchina's group contains plenty of females for him to choose from, and he doesn't appear especially interested. Finally, Ruchina relents. Twijike's entered a period called oestrus, a monthly occurrence for gorillas and the only time they can get pregnant.
And usually they'll mate about once an hour. There we go.
For the next few days, Trujike's sole aim will be to mate.
They are very active in soliciting the males. It is almost like it's a different gorilla from one day to the next, depending on if they're an estrus or not.
Possessed by her hormones, she turns once more to the silverback, but he's not interested. Twijike will have to look elsewhere. She decides to try her luck with the more junior gorillas, the blackbacks. Twijike might not know any better,
But the Blackback is only too aware that if he gets caught, there'll be trouble. The dominant Silverback holds priority and won't put up with this sort of behavior. Despite Ruchina's efforts to break up the young couple's embrace, sneaky mating does happen. Genetic tests have revealed that about 15% of infants are not fathered by the dominant silverback. It was a mating like this between Pinocchio's mother and a blackback that Martha saw before the young Pinocchio was born. Discovering who fathered little Pinocchio is important if Martha is to understand the secret world of gorillas. The only way she can solve this mystery is with a paternity test.
Oh, yeah. That would be Pinocchio. Yeah. So the size of the dung corresponds to the size of the gorilla. So we've been looking for some time now to get the feces from Pinocchio. And today we succeeded. It's tiny, tiny, tiny.
Martha will send this sample to a laboratory where Pinocchio's genetic profile will be compared to that of the silverback Ruchina.
Do you have the pen?
Yeah.
Congo, Magda is getting ready to meet the two orphan mountain gorillas and check that they're healthy enough to be moved to their new home. Ndezi and Ndakazi's stories began in 2007. When six mountain gorillas were killed in execution-style attacks, most likely linked to the illegal charcoal trade. Two-month-old Ndakazi was found clinging to the dead body of his mother, who had been shot through the back of the head. Around the same time, three-month-old Ndezi was discovered next to his dead mother. Altogether, five gorillas from his family had been killed, including the once mighty silverback, Senkwekwe, whose body was ceremoniously carried off the mountain. These atrocities shocked the world, but the real struggle was keeping the two young orphans alive.
It's all right.
They survived, but because of their contact with humans, they are unlikely to go back into the wild. However, soon they will be moved from this cramped back garden to a purpose-built sanctuary close to the forest that should be their natural home. To prepare for the move, the orphans are being introduced to the car that will eventually transport them.
Oh, yeah. Nataka Nindi. It's very important that they know what's happening. We don't try to sneak on them and do things by surprise.
Magda is happy that the orphans are healthy. But before she leaves Congo, there is a family of gorillas that she needs to check up on. One closely connected to the orphans. Chosen to stay with Silverback Ranu and his small, disgruntled band of gorillas. As their leader, one of Ranu's responsibilities is to keep the group safe. But now he is taking them out of the national park and onto the farmland that surrounds it. Ranu is desperate to gain the group's respect. Leading the gorillas out of the park to find a tasty treat could be a way of winning them over. But it's not without risk. Nestling beneath the volcanoes is the bustling town of Ruwengeri. Its ever-expanding population needs feeding, which means the last few hundred mountain gorillas on Earth face stiff competition for resources. Potatoes are the main crop grown here, but the gorillas ignore these and go in search of a different delicacy. Eucalyptus. These fast-growing trees are planted by locals to be used for building materials. This sort of damage does bring the gorillas into conflict with humans. But this is not the only concern for those looking after them. By coming onto the farmland, the gorillas are exposed to human diseases. Gorillas have little immunity to our illnesses. Even a simple cough or cold could kill them. Much work is being done to make people aware of the risks and benefits of having mountain gorillas living alongside them. And where better to start than with the next generation? At this school, the Art of Conservation team are teaching Rwandan children all about gorillas.
So approximately how many mountain gorillas are alive today?
About 700 up to 800.
Just as important as learning about mountain gorillas is the fact that the gorillas are helping to give something back to the local community. Money from gorilla tourism is used to build the very schools in which the children have their lessons. The future of the mountain gorilla is in the hands of the people that share this land. If both can benefit from this relationship, the gorilla's future will be more secure. Forest home in Uganda, the results of Pinocchio's paternity test have arrived.
So I just checked my email, and the subject heading is, the paternity of Pinocchio is solved. So I'm very curious to see, because he's nearly 1 year old. Yeah, so if there's no other options, the case for Ruchina as father is quite strong. Congrats! So yeah, Ruchina's the dad. That's exciting. Now we know.
Knowing the gorilla's paternity helps Martha paint a much more accurate picture of gorilla life. Although little Pinocchio is the son of Ruchina, this doesn't make his first year any easier. At 10 months, he's still pretty wobbly on his legs and only just beginning to explore his jungle playground. But once he reaches his first birthday, his chances of survival will increase. Through her close scrutiny of this gorilla family, Martha is finding silverback Ruchina to be a very successful leader. Part of this success is his ability to attract females. Unlike Ranu, whose only female is the elderly Tuck, Ruchina has 6 females, including the newly arrived Twijike. Young females often move between groups to avoid breeding with their fathers. But today, young Twijike seems happy to mate with just about anyone. She's already nearly been caught with one of the blackbacks, and that's a dangerous game to be playing. Her behavior has certainly stirred up the group. Twijike has now positioned herself between 2 blackbacks. Both are interested, but she seems to have a favorite. Sperm blackback spoils their game.
They started to mate, but then the other blackback grunted at them aggressively, very loudly, and then they stopped and the female moved off. There was a chance that Ruchina would come running.
If this goes on for much longer, the youngsters are certain to get caught. Rwanda, Felix has received the news about Ranu leading his group onto the farmland. He decides to find them. Although Ranu needs the group to help him attract more females, the group needs Ranu. Without him, the male blackbacks are too young to take on the responsibilities of leadership, and the group would fall apart. But now it's Ranu's leadership skills that are about to be tested to the limit.
There's another group close by, so what now they're doing is, chase beats, hooting from one side and then from the other side as well.
It's not uncommon for guerrilla groups to meet, and although potentially dangerous, it's a chance for females to switch groups. Felix is concerned that Tuck, the only female in the group, may take this opportunity to leave. But Ranu seems prepared to risk life and limb trying to hold on to her, even though she spurned him. Why he's so determined to keep hold of Tuck is a mystery, especially since she's unable to breed. For whatever reason, he continues to put on an impressive display in the hope he can ward off any challenger. The whooping is thought to be a way of filling the chest with air to help increase the effect of the chest beat. And right now, Ranu needs to sound as impressive and as powerful as he can. Felix radios the rangers tracking the other group. They're very close.
The other group is about 200 meters.
This could be dangerous for Felix and his rangers. No one wants to get caught up in the middle of full-on guerrilla warfare. But it's terrible news for Ranu, as it now seems inevitable that he will have to face up to a fight with another silverback. To make matters worse, Tuck is definitely showing signs of interest in what's going on. Already the blackbacks from both groups have started to mix, but this is not their fight. It's all down to the silverbacks now. Ranu holds back with Tuck, but a clash seems unavoidable. And Tuck doesn't make things any easier as she follows Ranu. This is a real test of Ranu's skills as a leader. With three silverbacks and seven females, the rival group is a big one. These females could use this opportunity to join Ranu, so the rival silverbacks are understandably cautious.
It's quite serious. Everybody's here, all the females, everybody's interested in the other group, so. It's a very tense situation.
If this escalates, Ranu could be badly hurt. The silverbacks posture to each other, turning side on to show their full might. Ranu must stand his ground if he wants to hold on to his group. As the gorillas size each other up, Ranu's stoic defense of Tuck seems to be working. The silverbacks realize that none of the females are ready to move. And since no one wants to fight, things begin to calm down. As the gorillas start to disperse, Felix senses that the situation has been defused. Ranu has handled this potentially disastrous encounter with great skill and courage. Whether this has been appreciated by Tuck and the rest of the group remains to be seen. Is on her way to visit the family of one of the orphans. News has reached her of a newborn baby in the group, and she wants to make sure it's healthy.
This is the biggest group on Congolese side, 36 individuals. A very unusual thing, only one silverback. Usually in big groups like this we had 3, 4, sometimes 5 silverbacks. In Congo side, since April this year, we introduced masks. So because of the health reasons and disease transmission, we all wear masks when we watch gorillas.
Congo is the first country to insist that all visitors to the gorillas put on face masks to prevent the spread of human disease. It's especially important, as these are some of the least visited mountain gorillas in the world. Magda makes reassuring gorilla sounds so that they are fully aware of her presence.
Mm-hmm. He's got his lunchbox with him. Mm-hmm. It's amazing time of year for gorillas now in Ovirungas with bamboo shoots. That's probably 90% easy of the diet at this time of year. Interesting group, that's by far the biggest of all the Congolese groups, and especially we would like to see the female Mahesha today. Maybe we are lucky to see her because she's the youngest in the history mother. She's only 6 years old and she already has 3-week-old baby, so we will try to see her if we are lucky.
Trying to see a mother and baby in a group still suspicious of humans is proving to be difficult. But But at last, Magda is able to get a glimpse of the newly born babe.
Sometimes with young females like this, they are confused. They don't know how to take care of the baby. Babies die within a few days, but this baby is already 3 weeks old, is holding well, is active, starts already looking at its surroundings. I think it's going to be okay.
With the birth of this baby, the group is slowly rebuilding itself after the horrors of the gorilla murders. War, poaching, armed rebels. The problems facing gorillas in Congo are immense. But despite all this, the Congolese are forging ahead with gorilla conservation. Looking after the animals are over 650 dedicated rangers. Often outnumbered and outgunned, over 130 have lost their lives in the line of duty. One of the biggest battles is against the illegal charcoal makers. Every year, hundreds of tons of charcoal are taken from the forest. For the local population, it's their main cooking fuel. Demand is high, and some of it comes from within the national park where the gorillas are found. It's the ranger's job to shut down these illegal charcoal-making operations. But it's no good cutting off the supply if the demand is still there. So ingeniously in Congo, they have come up with an alternative cooking fuel. Briquettes. The briquettes can be produced from all sorts of materials, including wood chippings, cardboard, even unused husks of rice. The process is simple and just requires a pressing machine to create the briquette. It's environmentally friendly and gorilla friendly. So far, 600 briquette making machines have been distributed, producing over 3,000 sacks of briquettes each month and creating more than 3,000 jobs. It's a great success story, and one that will help secure the future of people and gorillas in Congo. Martha's gorilla group is traveling deep into the forest. Gorillas can have a home range of up to 20 square kilometers, and Rukchina's group is nearing the very furthest boundary of their range. This is a four-hour hike for Martha and the team. But it's the only way for Martha to see if young female Twijike is still causing chaos in the group. They finally settle, and Martha gets a chance to look for the young troublemaker Twijike. She finds the younger members of the group playing in the undergrowth. But it's not just the juveniles enjoying this game. Twijike is also there, and all three are chuckling in delight. Thank you.
It's really nice because Tajike, the young female, was playing. And so, again, just how she's not quite an adult, but still not quite a kid. So, some days she's a young lady, but today she's trying to be a kid.
Tajike's venture into adulthood is temporarily on hold. And with that, the temptation for the Blackbacks to misbehave has gone. For now. The group has traveled close to the very center of Bwindi and the great swamp from which the park got its name. As the light starts to fade, the smaller gorillas take to the trees to build their nests. They make a fresh nest each night. A springy bed of folded branches makes a great natural mattress. Nothing beats a newly made bed in your own home. But for tonight, it's Martha and her team who will be without their creature comforts. Instead of trudging home, they decide to camp out for the night. Martha always enjoys a night under the stars, but tonight there's another reason she wants to be near the gorillas. There's a milestone coming up, and Martha can't miss it. Daybreak in Uganda. Martha is first up. For her, this is an eagerly awaited day. She's just a 20-minute walk from the gorilla's nesting site. Here's what Martha has waited all year to see. At last, little Ponoka is one.
This is sort of a milestone for Ponoka. About 1 in 3 infants don't live past age 3, so there's very high infant mortality. But most of the deaths occur in the first year. So now that Ponoka's reached 1, the likelihood of him surviving goes up dramatically. The population of mountain gorillas is so small that every single individual counts. It's nice to think that in 15, 20 years he might be a dominant silverback of his own group. I hope I'm still here then. I won't be running up these hills quite as fast, but yes, I hope so.
Reaching his first birthday is the first of many challenges he will face growing up as a male gorilla. But with a successful silverback leader like Rochina heading up his family, things are already looking good for his future. Under the watchful eye of Martha, Rochina is proving to be both a good father and a strong leader.
My hopes for Rochina and the rest of his group is that they live a natural, normal lifespan in a well-protected park. At the moment, Wendy is quite well-protected, so I have reason to hope.
It's also a big day for the orphan gorillas. At last, they're on the move. Having been passed healthy by Magda, they are driven 2 hours to their new home. It's this kind of commitment to the last few hundred mountain gorillas that's essential if they are to survive into the next century. Able to enjoy living in a much more suitable home. They can never go back into the wild, as it's unlikely they would be accepted into a group, but they have each other, and their new home is as close as can be to the forest they came from. Silverback leader Ranu, living on the slopes of the Rwandan volcanoes. Has the group finally accepted him? They certainly seem a lot more relaxed and at ease with each other. Heroic stand against a larger, stronger group has convinced the others that he might be a leader worth following. But what of his future?
They all need each other.
Yeah.
And Rano, as the dominant silverback, he needs all the support he can get from these guys, so let's, you know, give them some time, 3-4 years, they will grow and, you know, they start interacting, you know, having these encounters with other groups, and they will, you know, eventually attract females.
My hopes for Rano, I really hope, you know, he does get some more females in the future. I do like Rano.
He still has a long way to go before he reaches the status of his father, the legendary Titus. It would certainly help if he could attract more females, but with the hard-earned support of his fellow gorillas, at least he has the chance to follow in his father's footsteps. Ranu is also lucky, because as well as his group, he has the support of a dedicated team of scientists, trackers and vets, all working to ensure the future remains bright for every gorilla in this precious mountain kingdom. forest home in the heart of Africa, is one of the last 700 mountain gorillas that together are a species in intensive care. But it's exactly this kind of care and attention that has ensured that for the past 20 years, mountain gorilla populations haven't dropped or just stayed still. They've actually risen. Could the last few hundred mountain gorillas finally be safe in our hands?
In Albert Square for EastEnders here on BBC HD this evening at 10. And coming up next, slightly more exotic, we're off to Peru for Deadly 60.